Dylan. Dylan. Put the guitar down. Come here. How do I tighten this connection right here? Because it's wobbly. Oh, there we go. Thank you, thank you. Yeah, now I'm going to be using a lapel, but so we'll just go ahead.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, thanks. Good afternoon. Thank you for coming today. And that was a wonderful bus motorcade tribute. Did I say use the right term there? What's the correct term for that? I didn't hear it. Anyway, that was wonderful. Appreciate that. In fact, who are the drivers? Could we just see, raise your hand? Yes. Thank you for doing that. We appreciate that. We've gathered here today in memory of Robert James Canavese, who passed from us in death on early Thursday morning, February the 15th, just a month and a half ago. I'd like to ask you to listen as I begin our time together reading from God's Word in the Old Testament, Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, and though the mountains slip into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains quake at its swelling pride, basically, if everything around us is going crazy, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy dwelling places of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She will not be moved. Be still and know that I am God. God says, I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Speaking there about where we look or to whom we look for our refuge and our strength in time of need. In Psalm 62, we read these words, my soul, wait in silence for God only, for my hope is from Him. He only is my rock and my salvation, my stronghold, I shall not be shaken. On God, my salvation and my glory rest. The rock of strength, my refuge, is in God. Trust in Him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before Him. God is a refuge for us. We can trust in God at any time and at all times. And we don't have to give Him the stiff upper lip and put on a good show. It says, pour out your heart before Him. Share with Him what's going on in your soul. God is our refuge. And then turning to Psalm 103, this psalm was written by a king, a politician, a warrior, and a musician, and a poet. His name was King David. And he wrote this in Psalm 103, as for man, his days are like grass. As a flower of the field, so he flourishes. When the wind has passed over it, it is no more, and its place acknowledges it no longer. But the loving kindness of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. And His righteousness extends to children's children, to those who keep His covenant and remember His precepts to do them. And in those few words there, David was writing and saying, as for man, our time is here today and gone tomorrow. It's fleeting. But in contrast to that, God is eternal. And His loving kindness is for everlasting. And he extends that loving kindness to those whose hearts are reverent toward him. Turning to the New Testament, I want to read from 2 Corinthians chapter 1, just a couple verses. It says that in verse 3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction." So as we gather here today, we're going to be saying a lot of things and doing a number of things. But let's remember this. God is our Father, and he is the God of all comfort. And to comfort means to draw near, to walk with and to be with, to share as we go through these kinds of experiences. And the comfort we share with one another is really, ultimately, it says here, is sourced in God. Comes from him, and we share that with one another. And then in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I don't always read this, but it's very appropriate. "For we know that if the earthly tent, which is our house, is torn down." Now it's referring there to our body. You ever think of your body as a tent? Is it a pup tent or a cabin tent? But it's a tent. A tent is meant to be temporary. "For if we know that if the earthly tent, which is our house, is torn down, we have a building." Now contrast that, building and tent. "We have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For indeed in this house we groan." Anybody ever groaned in this house? How much do you think I can take? "We groan. In this house we groan, longing to be clothed with our dwelling from heaven." There is a longing inside of us for permanence, for that which is eternal, that which God creates. "For indeed, while we are in this tent, we groan, being burdened, because we do not want to be unclothed, but to be clothed, so that what is mortal," listen to this, "will be swallowed up by life." Isn't that a great phrase? That what we have is mortal. It's life, but it's mortal life. But there's this longing in our heart that our mortal life will be swallowed up by true life. "Now he who prepared us for this very purpose is God, who gave to us the Spirit, his Holy Spirit, as a down payment, as a pledge. Therefore, being always of good courage and knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord, for we walk by faith and not by sight," and those two things go together. We can't see God. We're absent from God, so we have to walk by faith and not by sight. "We are of good courage, I say, and prefer rather to be absent from the body and to be at home with the Lord." That's an entirely different perspective than the American perspective. The American perspective is, live this life for all it's worth, because this is the best we've got. And here is the Bible saying, this is but a tent. There's something eternal coming. And if we really saw the true perspective, we'd say, oh yes, that is far better. Today, Bob is with the Lord. We're reading this by faith. He is experiencing this right now. Isn't that amazing? Hallelujah. And then our last scripture reading coming out of the Gospels, John chapter 11. If you're familiar with this chapter, it's near the end of Jesus' earthly ministry, and he gets word that a friend of his is very, very sick. And this man is a brother with two sisters. His name is Lazarus. Mary and Martha are his sisters. Lazarus is sick. Please come quickly. Jesus got that message, and he stayed right where he was for 2 days. Then after 2 days, he said to his disciples, well, let's go down to Bethany, was the name of the town, and it was in the area near Jerusalem called Judea. Let's go down to Bethany. and minister to Lazarus. And they said, well, do you really want to do that? Because at this point in his ministry, he was a wanted man. The leadership was looking to arrest him and do away with him. And Jesus said, well, we must go. And Thomas, who often gets short shrift as doubting Thomas, Thomas stood up, spoke up and said, well, if he's going to go down and die, let's go die with him. And that was their attitude. So they made the journey on foot and came to the village of Bethany. And that's where we'll pick up our story. It says in verse 17, John 11, 17, so when Jesus came, he found that he, Lazarus, had already been in the tomb 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off. And many of the Jews living in Jerusalem had made that 2 mile journey to come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother Lazarus. Martha, therefore, when she heard that Jesus was coming, went to meet him, but Mary stayed at the house. Martha then said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Even now, I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. Let's just stop there for a minute. Did you hear those two things she said? She said, Jesus, why didn't you answer my prayer the way I asked you to? Why didn't you come when I asked you to come? Because if you would have done that, my brother would still be alive. So there's the questioning, God, why do you run the universe the way you, why do you run my life the way you do? But her very next statement is, but I know this, whatever you ask of God, he'll give you. So you've got faith and confusion all bundled up together. Anybody ever been there? I think we can all say, yeah, I can relate to that. Here's how Jesus responded. Your brother will rise again. And she responds back, Martha said to him, I know he will rise again. It's like, I know we're going to heaven. I am not talking about that. I'm talking about the life I'm living right here, right now, today, tomorrow, next week. I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. And Jesus responded to her, that resurrection you're talking about on the last day, now listen to this. He said, I am the resurrection. Wait a minute. Isn't this an event in time? And you're saying you are this event in time? No. The resurrection, for what all that it is, he says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Now, if somebody said that in our culture, in our world, we'd say, okay, that you're Looney Tunes here. Jesus is talking about two deaths and two lives. And the Bible says there is a first death, which Bob has experienced. But because he believes in Jesus, he will not experience the second death. And Jesus is saying, if you believe in me, even if you die, yet you will live. Because he says of himself, I am the resurrection and the life. And then he concludes this conversation with this question to Martha. Let me read it again. He says, everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? Lord God, as we begin our time together here today, there is this great question. What do we believe? Because we all, every one of us in this room, right here, right now, believes something. And so, Lord, we pray that as we have gathered here, by your Spirit, you would speak to us. There is a hope that goes beyond this life. It is good in this life, but it goes beyond this life. And that hope is rooted in the one who claimed to be the resurrection and the life, in Jesus. Lord, be with us here today. Be with each person who speaks and participates. We pray especially your comfort for Lonnie. Our dear sister, Lord, surround her with your love, your support. Be with us, we pray, during these next few minutes, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. At this time, I'd like to introduce Dylan and Shemaiah Anatok, who will be ministering in music.
All my life I've been carried by grace. Don't ask me how, 'cause I can't explain. It's nothing short of a miracle I'm here. I got some blessings that I don't deserve. I got some scars, but that's how you learn. It's nothing short of a miracle I'm here. I think it over and it doesn't add up. I know it comes from above. I've got miracles on miracles, a million little miracles. Miracles on miracles. Count your miracles, 1, 2, 3, 4. I can't even count them all. You helped me study so I wouldn't give up. You opened doors that nobody could shut. I hope I never get over what you've done. I wanna live with an open heart. I wanna live like I know who you are. I hope I never get over what you've done. It's not coincidence and it's not luck. I know it comes from above. I got miracles on miracles, a million little miracles. Miracles on miracles. Count your miracles, 1, 2, 3, 4. I can't even count them all. Miracles on miracles, a million little miracles. Miracles on miracles. Count your miracles, 1, 2, 3, 4. I can't even count them all. I can't even count them all. I can't even count them all. 1, 2, 3, 4. I can't even count them all. 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 1, 2, 3, 4. I can't even count them all. The miracles on miracles, a million little miracles. Miracles on miracles.
Count your miracles.
1, 2, 3, 4. I can't even count them all.
Thank you, Dylan and Shemaiah. At this time, we have a prepared video tribute for Bob and his life. And so we will dim the house lights and direct our attention this way for the video tribute.
Walk by your side.
only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? To my knees will I fall? I can only imagine when all I do is forever, forever worship you. And I can only imagine.
At this time, Bob's best friend, I believe from California, is that correct? Tom Bianchi is going to come and share some thoughts. You need to be about this close to it.
Okay, gotcha. I brought crib notes. I didn't really need them, but hey, there's so much stuff.
Yeah, you'll need to get really close to that.
That I want to do some highlights. I tried not to lose it, okay? I've known Bob for 48 years. I've met him at San Antonio Hospital. I'll make it, okay? He was my supervisor, and I hated that guy. He's always pushing me around. Hey, Tom, you gotta do this. He was always wanting me to do more. And he always said, you know, you're supervisor material. We gotta work you up a little bit. And I was a porter, and a porter at the hospital is the guy who mops the floors, buffs the floors, you know, you clean ceilings and you do that. And I was good at it, and I would knock everything out. I'd start at 7, and by 11:30, I was done. And so Bob sees this and says, oh, we got to give you more stuff. I'm going, really? Look, I got everything done. So he moved me up a step, and that was floating porter. And I got a beeper. Remember beepers? I got a beeper so that he would send me to the different parts of the hospital, and I would do work, and I was good at it. I got everything done. And he said, I want you to be a supervisor. And Bob was that guy, kind of guy, help you move along. Let's do more. And the requirements were you had to have 2 years of management at college. And I had never gone to management class, so he helped get the requirements changed that you only had to be enrolled in college to do it. So I enrolled, and I became a supervisor. Then I was making the big bucks, $3.50 an hour. Now, you remember that in the 70s? That was not too bad. So with supervisor, we got to be better friends, and we moved along. And I left there in 78, and my wife and I got married in 78, early part. So I knew Bob 2 years before we got married. I knew my wife and I were together from 75. But he came to our wedding, and he stayed at the hospital, and I moved on. I was a machinist in engineering. Said God blessed me with good hands and a good analytical mind, so I was able to really do well. But we stayed friends, and I even think we became better friends, because we were talking one time, like camping. He loved camping. I'll get there, okay? So we went camping a lot. I mean, we went to Lytle Creek. We went to the beach. One particular camping trip, they took a what they're called is those big trailers that pop out tents. Remember those things? So he got that, and Sylvia and I had our tent. And so he said he didn't have a truck or anything, so he was going to tow it with a pinot. And he did it. Seriously, Sylvia followed him down the freeway, and all you saw was this trailer. You know, there was no car above it. There's just trailer driving down the freeway. But he did it, so we got there, and we had a great camping trip. That was, like I say, this is one of our best ones. So we were up on the cliffs, and all day we're taking stuff down to the beach. You know, we've got blankets and, you know, what do you take down there? Everything, food and ice chests, and, you know, we're there until about dusk. And then it was time to take everything back. So we took 10 trips down and one trip back. We were just loaded with stuff going back up. Oh, man, that was something. But it was still a good camping trip. We had a wonderful time, and we always did with Bob. So, you know, like I said, we moved along and talked to Bob. Said, hey, we're going to move. He goes, yeah, okay, I'll help you. So we're not going to go into all the moves because Sylvia and I were trying to figure them out. There were like 17 between the two. We were always, you know, hey, I moved up to the desert and stuff. And he was always there for us. He never once even questioned it, because that was Bob. So we got to, you know, like I said, we kept doing better and better. And then Bob was the kind of guy that really helped people. As I can see, everybody here understands that. And my brother was kind of down and out. And Bob gave him a job with the insulation company and gave him a place to live on top. They had a room above the garage and gave him a place to live. Okay, that's Bob. Help people out, right? So that worked out for a while, and then later on, I'm going to kind of go through some things here. I don't want to bore y'all, okay? In Granada Hills, my wife did a craft fair. She was a promoter for craft fairs, and they did one there, and we did one up at the hospital there. And Bob was working there. And that's when we met Lonnie. We always call her Lanita then because, you know, she was so sophisticated. She was a manager, right? So she was, you know, we met her, and then it was her girlfriend came and said, "What's that guy Bob like?" You know, he's a great guy, man. Bob's really a good guy. You're gonna like him. I thought she was kind of interested, but I think she was interested for Lonnie. So we got to know each other better and became friends. And one day, Lonnie looks at us. "Why do you keep calling me Lanita? Everybody calls me Lonnie." So now she's our Lonnie. Yeah, so we got, then we all became good friends. And then one day Bob asked me, he's telling me they're going to get married. And I got the honor of being his best man. That was truly an honor. And that was, I'll make it, okay? And that was one of the best weddings I've ever been to. It was wonderful. Great people. You know, we just kept doing stuff. One of the fun stuff we did, Lonnie had a condo up the street from this big park, and it was the Cajun Festival they had there, and that was kind of our thing, right? Then that was one of the things we did is you go up to the Cajun Festival, and it was big. They had the people on the stilts. They had, the Creole music, and it was just all these booths. Conga lines, you could do that. They had, all the different kind of foods you could think of, crawdads, po' boy sandwiches, and one of the best ones was fried alligator tail on a stick. that was good stuff. So we did that a few years. And that was a lot of fun. So, and kind of moving along, we've always stayed in contact all the time. We're just really good friends. And he always helped me out whenever I could. If I needed something, Bob was there. Let's go back a little bit. When I worked at the hospital, I had to rebuild my truck engine, so we were kind of a little bit without a vehicle. And the hospital was not so far from my house, so I could walk there. And we would leave he let us use a Toyota Corona. This is not a Corolla. This is like the old, Corona. This is with the three on the tree. You know what those are? And it had a kind of a bad battery, right? So we were living in the little stone apartments in Upland. And there was two rows of little apartments and then the big house at the back. And that's where the landlord was. And so Sylvia goes out to the car and it won't start. Goes back in the house and gets a bottle of water, opens it up and pours the water in the battery. So the landlord's looking out the window, and like he restored Model A's and stuff, he knew cars. And he's just like, right, that's gonna work. So she pours the water in the battery, gets in and fires up. That's how Bob worked, man. It just mattered. But like I said, he just helped you all the time, and he just did things for you that you just never thought about. It was just, like I said, I could go on and on. But I've known him since he was a young man at the hospital. And he would always say, "Hey, we're more mature than those." I was 22, right? So, I was way more mature. So we moved again. This was the last time. He comes up and says, "Hey, we're moving to Idaho." "Okay, Sylvie, road trip." So we packed up, we rented a vehicle, and then Lonnie was behind us, and then we had the vehicle, and Bob led the way. And we helped them move up here. And we kind of like a little apprehensive, we didn't know what Idaho was like. So they took us all around, we're going like, this is good. We feel comfortable with them here. That's great. So it was nice, it was a nice move. And then we've come up several times. One of them we came up and for our business is, it's called Bianchi Beer Trails, okay? We help promoting breweries and that kind of thing. And they had a marketing conference in Boise. Said, "We're going. We're right near Bob. We're going, man. We're going to go see Bob and Lonnie when this was done." So we spent the weekend in the hotel and did the conference and then spent the next few days with Bob and Lonnie. Went to the that was the hot springs, right? Went up to the hot springs, and it was great. We had a great time. We always have a great time with them. It was wonderful. So then, here this last time, when Bob called and said he had cancer, that was tough. I'll be okay here. We knew it wasn't good. We called him in the hospital. I tried to contact him as much as possible. And then Lonnie said, you know, Bob, when you come home, Tom and Sylvia are coming up to see you. I think that gave him a little more encouragement to get home. So then we, as soon as he got home, you know, Lonnie said, you know, guys, it's ready. So we actually rented an Airbnb because, you know, it was hard for her to have somebody in the house also. And we came every day. And Lonnie picked us up at the airport. And Bob said, don't rent a car. You can use our 4Runner. It's like, okay, sure. He goes, are you sure? He goes, of course, you know. Just sits here. Use our 4Runner. So we got to use their 4Runner and went back and forth and visited them and hung out. And he seemed to really perk up. It was great. We went out to like a brewery, went out to dinner, and, you know, we had a lot of good times. And then and I said goodbye, hugged him, and told him I loved him. And then we came back. And a few days later, a couple weeks later, Lonnie called us and told us what happened. So Sylvie and I hugged each other and cried. I tried not to, but hey, I've known the guy for just a long time. And the toughest part is I never get to talk to him again. I never get a call. We always called and talked to each other. And I can't do that anymore. But we're always going to be close friends. I told Lonnie, hey, call us all the time, man. Come down, visit us. We fixed up a room for them to come down. So I got one last thing is I'm just going to say, everybody in this room and everybody you know, including myself, try to be as good a person as Bob was. Loving, sharing, honest, and he just takes care of you. So if we can all do that, this is going to be a much better world to live in. Thank you, guys.
At this time, we would like to give an opportunity for anyone who would like to come forward and just share a few thoughts or memories about Bob. The family, Lonnie wanted to do this, so just make your way up front, if you would, please. And it's only fitting that Hilda leads away.
If Bob was here, he'd make a joke about how short I am, because that was my relationship with Bob. I don't think we ever was in each other's presence without Bob making a joke about how short I am. And Lonnie would always say, Bob, shh, shh, that's not nice. And I'd say, just let him go. But you know what? I don't know if he drew them in together one night or one day at the hospital and said, I may not be here any longer. Please keep it up. Because the men in this body still, especially Ron, makes jokes about how short I am. But that's because they love me. And the last thing I want to say was, Bob was my friend. He was my friend, and I am going to miss that man greatly.
Thank you, Hilda. Is there someone else? Yes.
About 5 years ago, I was widowed, went to a class reunion, and found out I had missed a classmate. He had been widowed, and when we clicked it off, 412 miles for over a year before we got married. I told my girls, don't make it fancy, just make it very simple, because we've both been married before, and okay, Mom. So we had it in our backyard with tents. The cake was melting because it was hot. Things were kind of going our way, but who cared? We were married. We were sitting in the tent eating our cake before we left, and Bob and Lonnie were sitting in the table next to us. Bob leaned over, not knowing how very quiet and silent my husband is. He said, you guys busy tonight doing anything? We looked at him like, what? He said, are you guys doing anything special tonight? Because if not, Lonnie and I'd like to pick you up and take you to church. I looked him back and I said, I don't think so this time. He said, it's a one-time offer, Kay. I said, I'm sorry. That's who Bob was for me. He always made me smile. Lonnie was always there sometimes to hold me when I had some pretty tough times. Friends are one of the best things God ever gave us. Don't ever take them for granted.
Thank you, Kay. Someone else? I think we've got two men in Hawaiian shirts here. One's going to come forward. Maybe both of them, just to be safe. In fact, no, you don't have. Larry Gardner?
No. It's Scary Larry. That's what Bob called me the first time that he said that to me. I was shocked, and I didn't understand where it came from. And I wrote these remarks down because my memory's about that long. Something like that. Anyway, where am I? That's all right. I don't need that. Yeah, I know. But the first time I heard these two. That's where I was. Okay. Bob, and all I could come up with, the guy who was quick with a quip, was Big Bad Bob. And it wasn't very funny. So, but Scary Larry continued. I was searching for something to say about him, and I happened on a page of biblical truths that I'd written down based roughly on Galatians 2:16. A couple of those one-liners fit Scary Larry and Big Bad Bob. Make peace with your past so it won't screw up your present. It's never too late to have a happy childhood. With the second one, but the second one is up to you alone. No one else. Burn the candles. I'm sorry. but I appreciate the help.
Burn the candles.
At both ends? We use nice sheets. Wear the fancy lingerie now. Don't save it for a special occasion. Today is special. I don't know where it came from. I just thought it fit. I just thought it fit the occasion. Be eccentric now. Don't wait for old age to wear purple. What other people think of you is none of your business. These are, that one came from the Bible, did it not?
Hezekiah 4:13.
Okay, Hezekiah, okay. Don't take yourself so seriously. Nobody else does. Believe in miracles. God loves you because of who God is, not because of anything you did or didn't do. All that truly matters in the end is that you loved. Bob wouldn't have made up those stories about me if he hadn't loved. Life isn't tied with a bow, but it's still a gift. If Bob weren't playing in that little booth he hid in, I didn't know where I was sometimes. And I loved it when he got up to play. And all I can say is he loved. And thank you so much for letting me carry on just a bit.
Thank you, Larry. Very good job. Come on up, Ron.
This is a tough act to follow, Scary Larry. I haven't known Bob nearly as long as you guys. But over the last few years, I was blessed to spend my Wednesdays with him and a group of guys. Even when I was somewhere else, I was still accepted. And that was because of Bob. He invited us, invited me, we invited other people. Best part of my week was spending our Wednesdays together. Bob started the group for opportunity for guys to get together and share time together outside of church, as friends. And I've grown to love all these guys. In the last months of Bob's life, I was able to spend a lot of time with him, either at the hospital or when he was at home. Nearly every day, Bob would tell me, "I got an idea." Those ideas usually include one of two things, either busting him out of the hospital, or two, doing something to make Lonnie's life or someone else's life better, easier. Even when he was so sick, he challenged the home group he led to bless other people. When he heard there was a family that needed help, he challenged the small group to meet that need, always thinking about someone else. The years I got to spend with Bob as a friend, and they weren't many, but I'll remember them forever. I love you, Lonnie and Bob. couldn't do it without him.
Thank you, Ron. Phil Harding.
Well, what can you say about Bob? We were going to close our camp 2 years ago. Bob and Lonnie were there, and I just announced that, and he jumped up and just pushed me out of the way, and he said, no, we're not going to close it. We're taking an offering, and we will do another one next year. So we did. I've already forgiven him. He didn't come. I don't have a lot to say, but I think of a song Rhonda and I have sang many times. I'm just going to say a little line of it. I've got more to go to heaven for than I had yesterday. There's a brand new drummer in the choir, and I want to hear him play. Isn't that reason enough to go to heaven?
I think the answer would be, beats me. Someone else, please come quickly.
Now that's a dapper dude right there. You know, when Bob smiled, his whole body did. He just lit up and like he was gonna lift off or something. You know, he had what I call Bob-isms. He had come up with some stuff just out of the blue, just. And last night, visiting with some friends, my friend said something that reminded me of Bob. He and I were in a restaurant one day having lunch, and there was this guy next to us across the aisle, and this guy could talk more words in 1 minute than anybody I'd ever heard. His well of words had no bottom. And we're sitting there kind of oh-humming, and Bob leaned over and said, you know, I wonder if he was vaccinated with a phonograph needle. And it was one thing after another with him. Right, Larry? Yeah. It had been a while since I'd seen Bob, but we moved out of Idaho a couple of years ago, and I called him one day, just out of the blue, and we talked, and he said, well, I appreciate you calling and checking up on me. And I said, yeah. And it didn't register, but at the time, he wasn't well. And then some months later, I heard that he had gone into hospice. And, you know, Bob loved to break bread with his friends. And, did he love Lonnie? Oh. And he loved Gold Fork. We had a lot of fun in Gold Fork. Bob was a hot tub animal. And I asked him one day, we were going along doing something, and I saw this car, and it was a Lexus. And I said, who makes that? Because I rode Harleys. I never drove a car. And he said, oh, that's just a Toyota with lock washers. Just off the cuff, just off the cuff. He was a good friend. And I'll miss him. And you know, we sit here today and it's hard. It's hard for us because we're still here. And I realize that it's human nature to mourn. It's what we do. But I like to think that today, as we're sitting here mourning our loss of Bob, he is very much likely, think about this, he's very much likely, as we sit here today in mourning and celebration, that he is possibly sitting close enough to reach out and touch the hem of the garment. Come on. He told me once, he said, we were talking about dying, and I told him, before I knew the Lord, I feared death. And he said, me too. But he said, if you cannot live until you don't fear death. And there's only one way to do that. Later, Bob.
Anyone else? Okay. Oh, there is one more. Yes. Ebenezer Olatui.
Praise the Lord. I'm going to try to make it brief. I want to honor Bob and Miss Lonnie here, most especially the legacy of righteousness that Brother Bob, as I called him, left. I'm always willing to serve in the worship team, and not just that, in the home group. And there's something that endears my heart about people who love the Lord, and Bob exuded that. I mean, you could just see he was genuine about it. And I'm part of the young adults group in this local church. And you know, when Bob was in and out of the hospital, he requested that we just come to see him. And a bunch of us were around Bob's bed one Tuesday evening, and here was Brother Bob just doing what he does, challenging us to, you know, just be who God has called us to be, even to the very end of his life, encouraging us, pushing us to be what God has called us to be, encouraging us to reach out to each other with sincere love, and, you know, asking us about our lives, and just random stuff like that. I mean, he was laying in his bed and just really, really genuinely interested about what was going on in our lives. And I just want to say, Miss Lonnie, I tell people when I describe you and Bob, I say, Lonnie loves Bob. And you can see it. Perfect example of what a Christian marriage should look like. Just the way they deal with each other. A perfect example, you know, that we all can learn from. And I'm grateful to God that I got to know him. I'm grateful to God, like I said, for the legacy of righteousness he's leaving us. And I think it's worth celebrating his life and glorifying the Lord. And if Brother Bob were here, he will encourage me to tell you guys that Jesus over everything, right? And let's keep him in the centers of our lives. Amen.
That is certainly true. Bob and Lonnie loved each other. I don't know if you could measure who loved more most, because it had to be a tie, but you guys were devoted to each other. I think you're closer. Come on up.
I didn't have anything prepared today, but I brought a mug today. A bunch of years ago, we were having a Christmas over at Tethered Uncle Mike's house, and I found out that morning that Bob and Lonnie were going to be there, and I didn't have a gift for Bob. So I stopped by Jackson's, and I wrapped this right before we got in there. And I gave it to Bob, and he got a hoot out of it. And the best part of this gift was the next year that Bob actually gave it back to me. So I get to keep it now. So, but Bob was a good guy, so...
So the question in everyone's mind, was that mug filled on either of those turns? Oh, okay. Come on up, Linda Yetter.
There have been wonderful stories of Bob told, but Lonnie, I'm going to speak to you. Lonnie, you and Bob have a beautiful love story, and you have wonderful memories of all the adventures you had together. God knew Bob needed a wife who was up for travel, and God chose you. God knew Bob needed a wife who would explore other countries and share his love for Hawaii and be willing to move to Idaho, and God chose you. I know you never imagined losing Bob so soon, but you've navigated this season beautifully. We watched as you took outstanding care of Bob for 6 months. Every move you made centered around him, and we saw you. God knew Bob was going to need a loving wife who could care for him through a very difficult time, and God chose you. God knew that Bob's days on earth would be shortened, and Bob would need a strong wife who would put her hope in Jesus and trust God no matter what, and he chose you. God knew that Bob needed Jesus in his life, and God chose you to bring Bob to church as a condition of dating you. God chose you to be his wife. You loved Bob better than anyone else ever could have. You are thoughtful and loving and stronger than you knew. Thank you for sharing Bob with all of us. We love you, and you're never alone, because all of the people in this room also choose you to be our family and our friend.
Thank you, Linda. Anyone else? Okay, at this time, we're going to ask if Bob Hoops would come, and he's going to share a song. I think it was Lonnie's request, but at any rate, a song familiar to all of us.
I would just like to say that Bob was a nice-looking baby. And nice-looking 2-3-year-old. And turned out to be a wonderful man in his old age. And, you know, if he was here right now, he would be really pleased that everybody has said so many good things about him. And... that's about it. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. T'was grace that taught my heart to fear. And grace, my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear. The hour I first believed, when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining like the sun, with no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. May Bob rest in peace, and may I see him soon.
Thank you, Bob. Appreciate that. Bob was an integral part of our church here at Treasure Valley Worship Center. He was greatly loved, as you can tell by the comments that have been made. This was his home away from home here in the drum cage, where he was the drummer for our worship team. He was the leader of really one of our most successful home groups. We call it the Treasure Valley West Home Group. And I might add that group has not disbanded, and the torch has been passed to his wife, who is leading it. But the group is still going on. Also, I want to mention that our youth pastor, Galen, was actually one of the last people to see Bob before he passed, but you weren't by yourself. It was a Wednesday night, Valentine's night, and you took the youth group up to visit him in the hospital, and that was hours before he passed. So he was greatly loved here at our church. Had the chance to meet with Lonnie and let her just reminisce some, and asked her, well, how would you describe Bob? And she said a number of things. Of course, his bright blue eyes, and that, I don't know if you mentioned it, but I would add the twinkle that was in those blue eyes, along with his smile. She said he was her soulmate. And as has been mentioned, if you saw the two of them together, you certainly understand that. She mentioned that he had a quiet kindness and that he was very gracious, very loving, very charming. And as has been mentioned, he had an interesting sense of humor. I think Hilda has been referred to, but often he and Hilda were exchanging comments that would be in the hilarious or humorous category. I guess also, he never did this with me, but he would call people up and just speak in a foreign accent to them. Was that to try and make them not know who he was, or just to throw them off, or what?
It was just to be a goof-off.
He was very inclusive. In leading the Bible study, it was not like you're going to listen to Bob now for 30 minutes, but he would get the conversation going, the study going, then ask, well, what did you get out of that? What do you see here? So his heart was to include people, and I think that came out of another thing that Lonnie mentioned and that you alluded to, that he was an excellent manager, understood people, knew how to engage people, how to draw them out, how to encourage them. At the hospital, at the bus barn, Lonnie said he would just kind of, he'd watch people and kind of figure out the best way to reach out to them and then engage with them. So just Bob being a people person. Let me give a little history, and some of this has been referred to, but Bob's life started before Bob. Let's go to his dad. His dad was fought in World War II, not on our side. He was Italian, and he fought for Mr. Mussolini. He was captured. He and his troop were captured, and they were brought to the United States of America as prisoners of war, and somehow ended up in sunny Southern California. What a place to be a prisoner, right? Near San Bernardino, and got on the good side of whoever you have to get on the good side of to be able to get released on the weekends. Can you imagine just let out into the population? And so there was an Italian lady who lived in San Bernardino, and she would invite them over to her house so that they wouldn't get in trouble on the weekends, and fix meals for them, pie and coffee. And so Bob kind of fell in love with the United States. And when the war was over and he was released to go back to Italy, he decided, I'm going to move back to California. And so he did. He moved back to San Bernardino, where he had met people. And it was there. Did I have a been saying Bob? I mean, Bob's dad.
Yes,
Bob's dad, right. Okay. What was his name?
Al.
That would have helped. Yes, okay. So Al moves back. And that's where Al met Mrs. Al, his wife. And before you know it, here comes our real Bob.
Alfredo.
Oh, what?
Alfredo.
Oh, Alfredo. Okay. All right. So that's a little history of how. So Bob was a first generation American in that sense. Let's see here. We're skipping quite a bit from when he's born now to he's an adult. He's working, and he worked in a hospital in Granada Hills. In Southern California, and it was there that he met Lonnie. Lonnie also worked there. If I remember correctly, at first, you were not taken to him. But remember I said Bob, he studied people and he knew how to engage, and I think he focused on you. And so after a while, you began to pay attention to him. Let me get back into my notes here. So eventually they started dating, and they dated for a while. And then, as Linda referred to, Lonnie broke up with him because he was not a Christian, not a believer in Jesus. Well, about a year later, the phone starts ringing, and Bob's not ready to give up. And he keeps calling and calling, and you didn't return his calls. Look how close you, my goodness. But finally, you must have picked up the phone, and you agreed to go on a date with him if he would go with you to church. And so he was interested enough in making this work that he said, yes, I'll go with you to church. So they went to church, and after church was over, Bob was mad at Lonnie. He said, why did you tell that minister all about me? And Lonnie said, I didn't. Really? So some of you who know the Lord, you know how this works. While he was in that church service, God was speaking directly to him, and the Holy Spirit was revealing his heart. And when he realized that that's what was going on, he gave his life to Jesus. He became a born-again Christian, and he was all in. How about that? A year later, they got married. For both of them in their 40s. They had no children, so they traveled 7 times to Hawaii. Many of you are wearing Hawaii shirts, but that's because Hawaii was one of their favorite places. And every year they would go somewhere special. They moved here to Idaho, and before they got work and couldn't travel as much, he says, where do you want to go? And they actually went to a place in Idaho I've never been. I should have by now. Silver City. That's in the Owyhees, right? Yeah. In the Owyhees, yeah. So off they go. And I thought when they would show up at our annual Labor Day camping trips, church camping trips, that this was kind of a new experience for them. But I'm hearing, no, this is like past history in your DNA to go camping. How about that? They've moved and they're in Nampa. And Bob is the one who said, we need to find a church. And so they started calling around and found a church in Nampa where they attended and were part of that for many years. And then the Lord brought them here, was it 12 years ago? To Treasure Valley Worship Center, and they became a part of our church. You really would not know the true Bob if you did not realize that his faith was very real and very personal. And it wasn't religion, it was a relationship with Jesus. I don't know if he probably believed in God before he met you, but it wasn't until he met you and accepted Jesus that he had a true relationship with God as his Father. What we are doing here today, 3 things. Number one, we are honoring and celebrating the life of Bob Canavese, and we've done that. That's what we've been doing. And it's a good thing, and it's fitting that we do that. The second thing we're doing is we're saying goodbye. This is not the totality of that process, but it's a part of the process. And I think it's an important part of the process. And let's just remember where the phrase goodbye comes from. It's an abbreviation back as far back as the 1500s for God be with ye. Goodbye. And as we say goodbye to Bob, and we do, we'll miss him because there's an empty spot where he was in our church, in your home, in your heart, in all of our hearts. But as we say goodbye, we remember, but God be with you. He's with the Lord. And that's a good thing. So we're honoring him. We are saying goodbye. The third thing that we need to do, and as we draw to a conclusion here, is to reflect on Bob's life, but on our lives as well, on my life, on your life. One thing we want to do as we reflect is Bob's earthly life is over, but he lived that life to the fullest. How am I doing with living my life? That's an important thing to reflect on, because we get so busy doing it sometimes that we don't really reflect on what am I doing and why am I doing it? What is my purpose in life? And another reflection would be, now there's been many mentioned here, God, Bob's with the Lord, but there may be some here who say, well, that's a nice thing to say, but what do I believe happens when we leave this life? What do I believe? And everybody believes something. Maybe you believe that nothing happens. Maybe you believe it's ollie oxen free. Let's all head up to heaven. But what exactly do we believe? And that brings us back to the question that I read earlier, where Jesus came to where Lazarus had died, and he's talking with Martha, and Jesus says, I'm the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will never die. And then Jesus said to her, exactly what I'm saying right now, do you believe this? What do you believe? What Bob found when he went to church with you and then after that church service and he asked Jesus to be his Savior, what Bob found is that when we put our faith in Jesus and receive him into our life, that is when we become assured not only of what we're here for, but where we're going. And that is when we move from believing, well, there probably is a higher power and probably God, okay, to knowing God as our Father. It's through Jesus. Why is it through Jesus? Very simply. The thing that separates us from God is not miles or distance. The thing that separates us from God is called sin. Your sin, my sin, our sin. It's not that we didn't join the right church. It's not that we weren't good enough. The fact is, it's because we all are not good enough. So the answer comes from God, not from us. Very succinctly put in the most famous verse in the Bible, John 3, chapter 3, verse 16. For God, I'll editorialize a little bit, looked down and saw everything that was going on and said, what a mess, I am through with them. No, the next words are, for God so loved the world, he still loves each and every one of us more than we can imagine. For God so loved the world that he said, boy, I sure hope they figure this out. No. For God so loved the world that he gave. Well, what did he give? His only begotten son. God loved and gave his only begotten son. Why? Because we can't, no matter how many times we can't scrub out the sin. It must be paid for. The penalty must be paid. Jesus paid that penalty for us. God gave his son, yes, to be an example, yes, to be a good teacher, but primarily to hang on what that's a replica of, but it's a poor replica. It was not a polished, nice cross. It was a rough-hewn two pieces of lumber put together, and he was nailed to that cross and died to pay the penalty once and for all, for the sins of the entire world from generation to generation. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son so that whosoever, ethnicity, age, anything, whosoever believes in him, not a religion, not a special church, not their own good works, whoever believes in him would not perish. That's the second death. Would not perish, but have eternal life. That's the relationship Bob had with God through his son Jesus. And the offer of that relationship is to whosoever will. Anyone who would say, I'm tired of trying to do this on my own, or I'm tired of not being sure if I'm headed in the right place. Whosoever says, I'm ready right now, regardless of the past, and I can even say regardless of the future, to say, Jesus, I'll trust you to be my Savior, come into my life. He will come in. And I can tell you, on the authority of the Bible and multiplied personal experience, you will know that Jesus has come into your life and that you are a child, a son or a daughter of the Most High God, and that heaven is your home. We will close in prayer in just a moment, but first I'm going to ask if Dylan and Shammai would come for our closing song.
Everything new, Jesus, one day you will bind every wound. The former things shall all pass away, no more fear. One day you'll make sense of it all, Jesus, one day every question resolved, and every anxious thought left behind, no more fear. When we all get to heaven, what a day rejoicing that will be, when we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. One day we will see face to face Jesus, there is no other vision of grace. And in the moment we shall be changed, no more fear. And one day we will be free, free indeed, Jesus, one day all this struggle will cease. And we will see your glory revealed on that day. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be.
Thank you very much. Let's pray. And as we pray, just reflect again as we are honoring Bob here, but also reflect on your own life. If what I was sharing earlier was resonating with you, while I'm praying, I'm going to encourage you, just speak to the Lord. If you haven't welcomed him into your life, while we're praying, just say, Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. I'm going to ask you to come into my life. Make me new. Forgive me of all my sins. And let's begin living the rest of my life together. Could we pray? Dear Lord God, thank you for being with us here today. Thank you for the many, many fitting and honorable things that were shared regarding our brother Bob. And we rejoice, Lord, in the hope we have that is now reality for him, that he is with you. And we commit into your hands, Lord, his spirit. We also pray, Lord, for Lonnie, for all friends and family, but Lord, particularly for Lonnie, that you would strengthen her. Thank you for the years you gave her with such a wonderful man of God, just a wonderful man. Thank you, Lord. And may you continue to keep your hand upon her and bless her and let her be a blessing to others as she already is. Thank you, Lord. And I pray for her church family that we would continue to stand with her and support her. And then, Lord, for any who would say here today, I want to put my faith in Jesus, as the word picture you gave us, you said, I'm standing at the door, I'm knocking. If anyone opens the door, I'll come in. Lord, may they hear you knocking at their door, the door of their heart, and invite you into their life. Thank you. We pray all these things, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Now, everyone here is invited to stay for the meal that will be served, compliments of a friend through Olive Garden. But while the ushers are getting the chairs out and the table set up, Lonnie is going to be here in the front row, and I just ask if your front row would just stay there to support her. And I'm going to ask if you'd like to come and sort of come down this side and across and just express your condolences and your love to Lonnie. Let's take advantage of this opportunity while they're getting set up for the meal. Thank you very much. God bless you. I work at a church in Nampa. That's why I think it's good.
Good job.